What goes on? Thank you for letting us be ourselves. So don't mind me if I repeat myself. These simple rhymes be good for your health. To keep them crime rhymes on the shelf. Live, love life like you just don't care. 5,000 leaders never scared. Brain the noise is the moment they fear. Get up, celebrate for my dear.
Some shorts, look at the colour of your legs, then put on some sunglasses as well. It's Friday, we're live, and it's time for the last leg. Tonight on the show, Theresa May tries to keep face in Europe. We all try to keep our cool in the weather. And the ramifications of Grenfell Tower keep coming. Plus, we'll be joined on the couch by actress Kathy Burke and comedian Tez Ilyas on the show that just manages to keep its head above water. Welcome to The Last Leg, the show that's a lot like Glastonbury. A few famous guests, the odd song and some really backed up toilets. With me on the couch as always is the man who has recently stopped drinking, Josh Widdicombe, and the man who is now drinking for two, Alex Brooker. Before we get on to that, though, Nikki Chambers said, is it OK Richard Ioardi teased Alex with a golden hand, hashtag Crystal Maze? Alex was just on the Crystal Maze, if you were watching Channel 4.
Yeah, 2 hours of me. Channel 4's gone to shit.
and Richard Ioardi teased him with this. Now, that's harsh.
Well, it's a bit much, isn't it, when someone's got three working hands and you've got two-thirds? But the whole thing was, like, you know, kind of the producer said to me beforehand, look, there's some physical games. Which is basically a way of saying, don't try and be a hero, mate. Don't try and do shit. And then I put myself in a mental game and it's pushing buttons. I'm like, what the fuck is it? And as for the ending, when you're trying to catch the bloody foil paper, I just felt like a competition winner. I just felt like a hindrance, and it's for charity, but I just felt like going, I'm letting everyone down.
You let no one down. It was an amazing celebrity version. There was Louis Spence, wasn't there?
Yeah.
Aure from Strictly. Lydia Bright. The first game, if you didn't see it, it was mental. You went in, the room said, who is Lydia Bright?
Jesus Christ.
But the point we made earlier, Josh not drinking. For
yeah.
How long? How long are you going to be off?
Seven weeks. I've not done this before. Mm-hmm. I know you stopped drinking.
I haven't had a drink for 18 months.
I can tell you, honestly. Yeah. Not drinking, it is fucking shit. It's awful. This is the first time I've done the show sober. I thought you had all your fingers. It's unbelievable looking at.
There are some upsides. If you're looking for upsides of not drinking, you don't have to show your ID when you order a drink. I say that because I'm assuming you still have to show your ID.
Yeah.
So you stopped drinking because you were worried about getting ID'd?
No, I just decided to have a break. My tip is drink lemonade, because the sugar gets you through the night, and then the next morning, instead of waking up and thinking, oh my God, what stupid thing did I say last night, you remember every stupid thing you said last night.
So what I'm going to do, I'm not going to get liver disease, I'm going to get diabetes. That's what's going to happen. Basically, you're trying to make me lose a foot as well.
The only people disappointed in Josh's decision are the British paparazzi, because now instead of this, we're going to get this. As always, we will do our best to answer your big questions this week. You can tweet them to us at The Last Leg. Use the hashtag #IsItOK. For example, is it OK that Nigel Farage sent this tweet to Donald Trump on his birthday? Ooh. No. Is it OK to say that by the looks of the photo, I think he's got a semi on?
God, I wish I was drinking.
There is a lot of tough news to cover tonight, as there has been for the past month or so. I mean, it's been... Mm. Do you know what I mean? On top of everything else, then you've got this... We've had Grenfell Tower fire last week. We've got the attack in Finsbury Park this week as well. There's a lot to cover, and we're going to try and do it all, but we're not going to do it in one hit. We're going to space it out, if that's all right with you at home. And we're going to try and start with something slightly lighter, like Brexit.
God, I wish I was drinking.
Deborah Cooper said, is it OK that a year in from the vote, we still don't have a fecking clue as to what Brexit will actually do to this country?
Yeah.
Deborah, you're not the only one, as EU head honcho Jean-Claude Juncker was asked the same question this morning and gave a fairly succinct reply.
Mr. Juncker, are you getting a clearer idea of the kind of Brexit that the UK government wants?
No.
This is the thing. It does feel like we've done a week into negotiations.
Yeah.
We've kind of established that someone asked Philip Hammond, the Chancellor, they said, they've only really established one thing so far. And his reply was, well, when you move into a house, you don't move all your stuff in on the first day.
Mm.
Yeah, you do. That's how moving works.
Well, a year ago, Sky News were running this ad to reflect how the referendum was going to play out. One year on, and the negotiations could best be summed up by a clip of BBC's Hugh Edwards from this week.
Do you know what he looks like? It's like when you go to the toilet and you've forgotten to take your phone with you.
The toilet duck again!
Theresa May was in Brussels last night for a dinner with EU leaders to discuss Brexit, and today we were all wondering what was on the menu. Humble pie, Eton mess or a giant shit sandwich?
Bet you at that dinner they shafted her with a bill massively. Just off us going, Luxembourg, did you have Chris Stout for dessert?
It would have been the best come dine with me ever. Just Jean-Claude Juncker going, I'm going to give her three. She wouldn't shut up about Brexit.
The EU's Donald Tusk quoted John Lennon when he was asked if he could imagine the UK staying part of the EU.
Who knows? You may say, I am a dreamer, but I am not the only one.
I mean, he's got a whole stack of those ready, hasn't he? You know what I mean? If it starts going well, she loves EU, yeah. I've got my mind set on EU. I'm assuming we're just going to see him wander down the hallway one day just going, Angela Merkel sits on her own in a room as she saves the EU. What can we do? I've got more. Article 50. What?
I don't get it.
Do you know the worst thing? It's so expensive to clear Beatles music for TV.
Yeah.
That gag cost us 50 grand.
Our poll for tonight, what other song lyrics apply to Brexit? Brexit and Tiffany's, perhaps? Tweet us at The Last Leg, use the hashtag Brexit lyrics.
Brexit
and
Tiffany's.
All right.
No, I like it.
No, what have you got?
Brexit and Tiffany's!
Yeah, I like Brexit and Tiffany's.
I love Brexit and Tiffany's, yeah.
Yeah, I know that one as well. The others I didn't, you were just on about, but that one I did.
Have you heard of the Beatles?
Yeah, just a bit of banter, innit?
That's Adam's chat-up line. Have you heard of the Beatles?
Apparently, Theresa May spoke to the leaders of the 27 EU countries last night, then had to leave. So she talked to them all, then she had to leave while they chatted amongst themselves.
I bet she was there, glass to the door, listening to all slagging her off.
Why did she have to leave? Did she go too hard too early?
You shouldn't
have started drinking at three, Theresa. You'll never make it through till midnight.
Theresa May made what she called a fair and generous offer to allow EU citizens to stay in the UK. There's this weird thing where basically you're allowed to stay for up to 5 years. If you stay for 5 years, you become a citizen. It's all... I mean, a lot of people criticised it for being a bit vague and a bit late, and that's exactly what I've just done as well. The offer raised a lot of questions, though. People are unsure of what it actually means. For them, the truth is, the one question we all need an answer to is this. Can the cheeky girls stay? In fact, I think that's how Theresa May should explain the offer to the EU. Just go, right, the cheeky girls can stay as long as Sean Connery gets to keep his holiday house in Spain.
I can imagine doing an exchange, like on Bridge of Spies, with expat celebrities, with celebrities we've got here. So, like, Bruno Tognoli would be walking over a bridge at the same time as Wayne Lineker's coming the other way.
Earlier in the week, the negotiations kicked off. The British underdog, Brexit Secretary David Davis, went toe-to-toe with the three times undefeated EU champion Michel the Barnstormer Barnier. Davis and Barnier, apparently these guys have known each other for ages, so they gave each other hiking-related gifts.
Dweebs.
Davis handed over a rare book on mountaineering. Barnier gave him a traditional carved wood hiking stick, as you can see in this awkward photo.
Sweet.
I mean, either that's symbolic or they once had a Brokeback Mountain moment we don't know about.
That is a great example of re-gifting. In that book, it says, to David from your wife, Merry Christmas.
I think the motto of the negotiations may well be, I wish I knew how to quit you.
I reckon there's probably just a hiking shop next to the building where they met up and they're like, fuck, we're meant to do gifts.
The gifts were given, the distance between them and us was obvious once the negotiation started.
That, I love that picture. What I love about that picture is it looks like that TV screen's about to turn on and Alan Sugar's going to go, teams, I brought you to the Natural History Museum to set you a task. I want to mix you up. David, you're going on to the EU team this week.
Sunburnt Squirrel said, I didn't realise you were moonlighting in the porn industry, Adam. Is it OK and linked to this porn film? I mean, does that really look like me? As Jizza Corp? Yeah, it does. Oh, God, that's just... Hang on, is that the look? Yeah, it is, isn't it? That's awkward.
So all those tweets about Adam Hill's a massive dick, that's what that was about.
Now, while all of this goes on in Brussels, back home, Theresa May is still trying to form a government with the help of the DUP. Siobhan Moore said, is it OK to ask if we can refer to the Tories' DUP as a no-alition? Theresa May's Queen's speech went ahead this week. Despite no deal being formalised with the DUP, some of the main manifesto points from the Tories were absent, though. There was no mention of the dementia tax, the cuts to school lunches, Donald Trump's state visit, or the vote on fox hunting, all of them gone. Biggest climb down from the Tories since Boris Johnson got stuck in that harness.
Well, presuming it's a climb down, I like to think that the Queen just left one piece of paper in her printer.
I reckon when they eventually do reach a deal, Arlene Foster's the sort of person go, we're not signing a bit of paper. There you go.
Now, there are rumours that the DUP want £2 billion in funding for Northern Ireland. There is no truth to the claims that they want it officially recognised that the Giant's Causeway was created by actual giants.
Theresa May needs the DUP so much, they can basically just ask for anything. They can be sat there in the negotiations just going, want £2 billion, those trousers. Are you eating that? Like, I reckon what we're going to end up at the end of the deal...
What she's eating.
Sandwich. But I reckon what we're going to end up with, probably, she'll end up giving them the £2 billion. We'll have, like, a paramilitary mural on the Houses of Parliament, and Larry the Downing Street cat is going to have to change his name to Billy and have 1690 shaved in his fur.
Apparently, at one point, the DUP refused to answer any calls from Theresa May for 36 hours.
That's because they're so old-fashioned that they don't believe that mobile phones are anything other than pure evil magic.
Not true, by the way, that Theresa May left a message at 3 a.m. drunk singing Come On, Arlene.
She's so bad at closing a deal. I think I'm going to see Theresa May in WH Smith with a telegraph buying a bottle of water separately. We'll see her in boots going, I didn't know apple ties wasn't included in the meal deal.
The DUP actually told journalists they were, quote, surprised at the low level of negotiating experience in May's government. So, like, that augurs well for us all.
But I think for, like, Theresa May, all these negotiations must be, like, a really nice change for her, because, like, even being shouted at by Europeans and the DUP is better than probably the voices that go on inside her head that are so fucking bleak. Just the voices of all, like, the disabled and poor people just chanting, you fucked us, you fucked us,
you fucked us. I love the fact that you've been taken over by Frankie Boyle. Theresa May's colleagues has made you really angry.
Theresa May's colleagues say they're firmly behind her, but there has been talk of replacing her. The question is, with whom? Chancellor Philip Hammond made a speech that was described as wide-ranging this week, which is a euphemism for, give me the keys, I reckon I can drive this baby. Boris Johnson, on the other hand, did the media rounds. Listen to him squirm as Radio 4's Eddie Mair calmly questions him.
What does this Queen's speech do to make sure the criminal justice system stops treating black people more harshly than white?
Well, there are measures in the, I believe, in the bill on the courts, which I think is supposed to address some of those issues. And I think one thing in particular that we are looking at is measures to. Hang on a second. There are all sorts of measures that we want to take to ensure that. We do not discriminate against everybody. And
what does this Queen's speech do to improve mental health care?
Well, what we want to see on mental health care is a proper understanding. And there, indeed, I think you will find, to get back to your first question.
Well, why don't we do the questions in the order I'm asking them? It's not a too Ronnie sketch. You can't answer the question before last.
So, as far as both Boris and Hammond's leadership aspirations went this week, it was good night from me and it's good night from him. Chris Knox said, is it OK that Dennis Skinner was again the best part of the state opening of Parliament? There are so many amazing, weird, wonderful parliamentary traditions in this country. But one of my favourites that I only found about this week, MP Dennis Skinner traditionally heckles the announcement of the Queen's speech. So everyone was waiting for his regularly scheduled zinger, and then he made a reference to the fact that the Queen was on her way to Ascot by saying, get your skates on, the first race is at 2:30.
A year, and that's it. Come on, mate, I do 30 jokes a Friday.
I want to know
no,
if the
Queen...
I reckon the Queen must have... Like, I felt a bit sorry for her having to be there, cos she must have been livid about going to Ascot late. There's nothing worse than playing catch-up. Is there? When everyone's already there, I reckon she went in her carriage, she started smashing all those little M&S cans of G&T. She was on it by the time she got there.
I wish she'd done it on the way to Glastonbury. That would have been... She'd been in her wellies with a huge flag.
I'm hoping that she prepares a heckle comeback for next year. I'm hoping she sits there, maybe goes to some stand-up comedy clubs, works out how it works. Next year she gets heckled and goes, listen, I'm working here. I don't come to where you work and slap the sailor's dicks out of your mouth.
I'm hoping she does that as well. Because if she doesn't, you could well be hung for treason for that.
I reckon it would have been great if she'd been wearing earphones during the speech, then stopped mid-sentence, sworn, torn up a betting slip and then just got back onto it. One of the oddest, most archaic traditions involves Black Rod, who has the doors of the House of Commons slammed in his face before then banging on them with his rod to summon MPs to the Lords to hear the Queen's speech. It looks like this.
Close the door!
It's kind of like one of those, like, when you go to a party and everyone pretends that, well, let's pretend we're not in, bit of banter.
Every time I heard the words Black Rod, I just wanted to say, Bambalam.
He was also in the hard Brexit film, wasn't he?
So there's a vote coming next week, basically, on Wednesday, on the Queen's speech, because it hasn't been passed yet. So what's going to happen? If the DUP abstain, then Theresa May only has a majority of two. So she kind of needs to keep everyone on side. And that is particularly tricky. How tricky? Right, I'm going to try and demonstrate exactly what Theresa May needs to go through next week. Because here's the thing. Before the election, she thought all she had to do in the Queen's speech was keep the Tories happy. Right? Now, she's got to keep the DUP going as well. But if she's looking after the DUP, she's got to keep Sinn Féin on side. Not just Sinn Féin, Wales is in there as well now. Sorry, I'll throw you Wales again. This is exactly how tricky it is. There you go. Now, Scotland's got to play a part in the whole thing. And if that's not enough, Brexit is coming along pretty soon. And on top of all that, Jeremy Corbyn's ready to swing in, take her out at any moment. I mean, honestly. Tonight's first guest. Sorry? No, that is, I mean, that's exactly, that's one
I'm
of the
really
scenes.
I'm really hoping that tonight's first guest is the real Jeremy Corbyn.
I'm hoping it's not a lawyer. To bring on the first guest, Black Rod, would you do your thing?
Sorry. first ask, you couldn't see what happened there?
I could.
All right.
Did you almost turn back round?
I thought it was great.
Welcome to the show. I want to start by referencing a tweet that you sent yesterday that said, this is a last-minute booking on the last leg, so I've not had a chance to get me feet done. Don't judge me.
Yes.
Yeah. I'm just going to say, of all the shows, to not worry about your feet.
No, exactly.
You're worried that you had a lost one.
In the news, Melissa Kimber said, is it okay that I find Brits complaining about 30 degree days amusing? Hashtag 30 is virtually winter in Australia. Hashtag get some vitamin D.
Vitamin.
Look, I realise it wasn't hot everywhere around the UK this week, but it was in London, and it was, as an Australian, it was kind of hilarious. It was just, oh, we need hot. Oh, it's so hot. It's 31.
Yeah, that's hot.
Yeah, no, it's not.
Yeah, it is.
How'd you cope with it, Kathy?
It was horrendous. I was sweating like a 53-year-old menopausal woman.
Do you not think, though, that when it gets to that heat, you start to almost take it personally? You find yourself sat there going, this sun's taking a fucking piss out of me.
Well, and people, when it's hot, people ask me for tips as if I know what to do when it's massively hot. But when it's 31, it's not... For me, it's not massive.
Where is Australia? The centre of the sun?
31's just a lovely day. And what I think, what people think is a heat tip, for me, it's just common sense. It's just something that most people have never thought of. So I've prepared a few heat tips to get you through the upcoming summer.
KLC's heat tips.
Walk in the shade.
KLC's heat tips.
Alex, you cooled off in a...
What? Do you know what?
What more do you want?
I still don't understand why we didn't win that BAFTA.
I ended up getting a paddling pool for my front garden because I was so hot.
Oh, like a little doll?
Yeah. Oh. When I was in it, we had a new neighbour that moved in. So he started moving into his new place and seen on the front lawn just me lounging like some little whale that's being kept alive with a calippo.
I mean, I don't think he was going to ask you to help move boxes, though, was he?
Don't know, mate.
Well, the weird thing is we actually have footage. You don't know this, Alex. We've got footage of you in the pool. This is Alex being very animated whilst enjoying his paddling pool during the week. A lot of people found it hard to sleep during the week with the hashtag too hot to sleep going around.
The thing with the sleep, I never know whether it's the heat or my conscience. Am I the only one that gets that?
I understand it is difficult to sleep. I think it's time for another one of these.
KLC's heat tips.
Buy a fan.
KLC's heat tips.
You see them getting a round of applause now. Isn't it?
While Prince Philip wore civvies to the Trooping of the Colour, the Guardsmen were dressed in full finery, leading to the annual fainting of the Guardsmen. Watch the second row of guards on the left. They just leave him there.
Can I speak for all of us when I say we all wanted him to fall left and right and them to go down like dominoes?
Well, apparently they're trained to fall forwards. If you feel yourself going and your knees start to buckle, just face plant because then you don't take anyone out. That's exactly what they're trained to do. I know.
What a country we live in.
And look, I'll admit, I probably did bang on a bit about how bad British people are at handling the heat. Alex, you got... Well, you were quite sick of it.
Yeah, you were doing me head in over it, truth be told. So I set you a little challenge earlier, didn't
you?
Because I wanted to see, because you were so smug, I wanted to see how you got on in a really, really hot room, dressed in one of those guardsmen's outfits, while you were doing hot yoga. And for anyone who's wondering why the hot yoga, it was basically, I'd have been watching it anyway, so I thought I'd kill two birds with one stone. So
we filmed it. I genuinely did do this this afternoon. And take a look.
Thank you.
My bear skin's gone with my downward dog. This may surprise you, but I'm not built for standing on my right leg.
Fair play to you, mate. I didn't think you'd stick that out.
Well done. Unfortunately wet down under. Would you mind rolling up my yoga mat for me?
Yes, mate. Here you go.
Cheers. For you after the break, as we look at the aftermath of the Grenfell Tower tragedy. Plus, we do want to know what other song lyrics apply to Brexit. Tweet us at the last leg, use the hashtag Brexit lyrics. We'll see you soon. Welcome back to Last Leg, where we're still joined by Kathy Burke. Eric Windross said, is it OK to ask where the Trump jar is going? I can't remember. It seems to be that long ago since it started. We've got a Trump jar.
All right.
We thought every time we mentioned Trump, we should put some money in the jar. And we decided all the money was going to go to a Syrian refugee charity, because that's what he'd want.
Oh, you should put it towards the wall.
Towards the border wall.
The wall.
Yep.
Look, I know we said this thing about that it was going to a charity, but I genuinely believe that that was going to our end of series party fund. And I thought, as you two weren't drinking, I was going to have a touch.
I've invested in a vodka luge and I need that money, big star.
There is a few hundred pounds in there. We are going to give it... it was World Refugee Day this week, so we're going to give it to a Syrian refugee charity, as promised.
Great.
Now... We touched briefly on the tragic events of Grenfell Tower last week, but as the fallout continues, Chris asked, is it OK that the Kensington and Chelsea Council paid a £100 rebate rather than invest in cladding that would have saved lives of Grenfell residents? Now, as the death toll rises this week and as 800 residents in Camden are now being evacuated from their tower blocks, it was revealed this week that the richest borough in the richest city in one of the richest countries in the world recently paid a £100 bonus to council taxpayers because they had a surplus. But if that rebate had been held back from just 50 people, they could have paid the extra £5,000 that was needed to cover Grenfell Tower in fire-resistant cladding. Now the questions, there are possibly another 600 buildings with the same cladding. Was the insulation toxic? Were regulations ignored or not good enough? I mean, there's a lot to get through now. How do you think Theresa May's handling it?
Well, you're asking me? Well, it's appalling. She's just been useless. But she didn't do herself any favours last week by not visiting people that lived at Grenfell. And I just couldn't get my head round why she did that. Why she, you know, visit, you know, said hello to the fire service, absolutely. I just couldn't get my head round why she then pissed off.
Do you think
I just thought it was so insulting and really thoughtless, and I don't know who's around her. I mean...
Do you think she knew that if she had turned up... I mean, she did invite people to Downing Street and they did come inside, but do you think maybe she knew
that... Yeah, she had to invite them there, because there's nowhere to sit at their place, is there? They're going to go to Downing Street.
Would, do you think Boris would have done a better job?
Oh, Boris could go fuck himself.
You're sitting on the fence about Boris, then.
I think I need to provide...
Please welcome Boris Johnson!
Now, you've got some mates helping out with a book as well for the Grenfell Tower.
Yes, I have. There's some lovely people. There's a guy I know called Paul. I must say hello to his daughter, Martha, because she's only 12, and she loves The Last Leg.
Oh, wow.
And she's always allowed to stay up and watch The Last Leg, you see. Oh,
not after this week.
No. But anyway, Paul and his friend... they've come up with an idea which is really good, I think, and it's going to be 24 short stories.
Right.
Because there were 24 stories at Grenfell.
Yeah.
And 24 positive stories. We're going to have some established writers, but mainly writers that have never been published, normal people, just normal everyday people that can write and like writing stories, and they're going to be put in a book. and the money will go towards post-traumatic stress disorder treatment for survivors of Grenfell. And I think it's great, and I'm really behind it. And they're on Twitter. The Twitter thing is 24 stories.
24 stories.
So you can look at that on Twitter. If you want to contribute, you can. Not everyone's story will get in, obviously, because there's only room for 24.
Yeah.
But I just thought it was a wonderful idea because this young woman, Rose, she's going through treatment herself.
Yeah.
And it's been immensely helpful to her. And that's why she thought, these people are going to need this.
Yeah.
Because this is going to stay with these people for the rest of their lives.
Yeah.
It's not, you know, everything happens so quick nowadays. And all these disasters and terrible things happen. And we talk about them so quickly. And then we forget about them so quickly. But the people that go through it, I mean, it's with them forever. And I'm a great believer in therapy and counselling and talking, which is why I'm sort of quite fond of old Harry at the moment, because I think he's doing a great job speaking his mind. So, anyway, I think this book is terrific, and it's Martha's dad, Paul, who's set the whole thing up with Roe, and I'm delighted to be a part of it and support them.
And I think you're right. I think we move on, often we move on too quickly from these things, and I think we've got to, for the people, for the victims, for the survivors, but also trying to work out what happened. We've got to make sure that happens, because right now everyone is trying to blame everybody else. Everyone's saying, well, it was the cladding or it was the regulations. And do you know what? No matter what happened, Grenfell really is a symbol for the massive divide between rich and poor in Britain. And
not just... I live in Islington, and my local MP for 25 years is Jeremy Corbyn.
Yeah.
I've never once had a council rebate, mate. You know what I mean? That just doesn't go on.
Right.
You know, you pay your council tax and it goes to the people that need it.
Yeah.
We've never had a rebate.
Do you know what I think is interesting? A lot of people thought, you know, Brexit, they didn't see Brexit coming. They didn't see Donald Trump being elected president. They didn't even see the rise of Jeremy Corbyn. And I think it all came from the same place. It came from people who were feeling neglected. They're doing it tough, they're feeling neglected, and that's why they needed to have a voice. Nine out of the 10 poorest regions in Northern Europe are in Britain. I'm going to say that again. 9 of the 10 poorest regions in Northern Europe are in Britain.
I was looking into that earlier, and do you know that most in those regions, the majority of them voted Tory?
Yes.
I found it absolutely baffling. It's like, kind of like voting to get punched in the face.
Well, Kensington's the richest area in Britain with the lowest taxes, but a lot of Kensington residents are foreign investors who don't pay very much tax, as it turns out. And the government might say that, yeah, but they keep the country afloat. But the people that lived in Grenfell Tower were taxi drivers, NHS employees, social workers, artists. They're the people that keep the country running. And this isn't about austerity, because these cuts, we know these cuts don't need to be made. And this isn't just me saying it. This is about a government who believe it's not their job to help people up when they've fallen down. And look, Nick Clegg said that when he was Deputy Prime Minister, and he couldn't remember, it was either George Osborne or David Cameron said to him, and just take this in, was said to Nick Clegg, I don't understand why you keep going on about the need for more social housing. Mm. It just creates Labour voters. Do you know what doesn't create Tory voters? Up to 100 people dead in a fire because of neglect. That is a remarkable quote, and it's hard to believe anyone actually said it. Now, look, like I said earlier, we are trying to space out the tough news with the silly, so we've covered Grenfell. We need to... A bit of
you
a...
You talk shaking.
Oh, I didn't mean that. I'm so sorry.
I'll tell you what, thank God that happened then.
Yeah, it's gone. We need a palate cleanser. Let's talk about Ed Miliband. Ed Miliband this week. We've said it a lot, but Emily asked, is it okay that Ed Miliband tried to roar on Radio 2 this week when talking about heavy metal? Ed Miliband is hosting a radio show this week and was taught how to do a death metal roar.
You're going to try and help me to sort of do a bit of this extreme metal, is that right?
Yeah, if you like.
Go on.
Yeah.
Go on. Do you want to just...
Is that right?
Right. That wasn't me.
That was very easy for me.
That was him. Yeah. Just do it again and then I'm going to try.
Is that right?
Let me have a go.
Oi! No, you need more throat.
I need more throat.
More throat, yeah.
It sounds like... Oh. It sounds, you know when you almost knock over your pint, you're like, whoa!
Do you reckon he did that when he saw the tablet and just nobody heard him? Did you just hear him say something?
I wish he had done that in that interview before the last election when Jeremy Paxman said, are you tough enough? And he's gone, hell yes, I'm tough enough! It's kind of like, I mean, well, thanks to Ed Miliband, by the way, for giving us a laugh this week. It's almost like he's gone on a gap year to find himself because he's tweeting, he's hosting a radio show. He's going to turn up to the Commons with, like, dreadlocks, a henna tattoo and a shark tooth necklace. If that wasn't strange enough, though, he also hosted a radio phone-in on toilets and the different types of flushers.
That's a good phone-in. I like it.
Yeah, well, there was a report that said newer dual flushers can waste more water. It was candid, it was relatable. Some guests even flushed their loos live on air for him to judge. This, by the way, was our highlight.
I'm glad to say we've also got Jim Doyle on the phone, who's also got strong views on this topic. Is that right, Jim?
Yeah, good morning. I have. I redone my house probably 10 years ago, and I fitted all these new toilets. And I'll tell you what, I despair since. They don't hold enough water. I don't know how politely to put it. When you go have a big job...
Be tactful and diplomatic, yeah.
Yes, I'm trying to be. It'll take 3 or 4 flushes to flush it away, and then you're left with skid marks down the bottom, so you've got to get the brush out.
I can only apologise to people eating their lunch at this moment.
Yeah. Thank you, Ed Miliband. We can't thank you enough. We'll be back with more of The Last Leg in a minute as we talk to comedian Tez Ilias about radicalisation. Plus, we want to know what other song lyrics apply to Brexit. Tweet us at The Last Leg. Use the hashtag BrexitLyrics. We'll see you soon. The Last Leg, where we're still joined by Kathy Burke, and it's time to introduce our second guest. He's a comedian, a presenter by the name of Tez Ilias, but first we need to call back the Black Rod, Bambalam. Ladies and gentlemen, it's Tez Ilias. Tez, welcome to the show. How did you deal with the heat during the week?
Oh, well, for me, because I'm Muslim, it's slap bang in the middle of Ramadan at the moment, so yeah. Basically just hibernating, trying to stay out of the heat as much as possible so I can stay alive. If you don't know what Ramadan is, it's like Lent, but on speed.
You're allowed to take speed?
Yeah.
Now, the best and worst of people was on display again this week after a man drove a van into a crowd of people in Finsbury Park as they finished their Ramadan prayers. While one imam protected the attacker from the baying crowd and kept him safe until police arrived, one pensioner the next day drove her mobility scooter from Ilford to Finsbury Park to pay her condolences and thank the imam for his actions. Now, you live in that area, Kathy. Yes,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes.
I mean, that man... Let's be honest, the imam said, I'm just doing what I'm supposed to do, but that, he's the hero of the week, as far as I'm concerned.
I totally agree. I think it's great because, I was just about to go to sleep.
Yeah.
I sent my lover home and...
Can I say you did not pay for my bus fare?
But I was just about to drop off and, listen, there's always helicopters and sirens and that's London, you know?
Yeah.
But it just was going on and on and on. And I thought, crumbs, there's something afoot.
Yeah.
And, he's at my age, something.
I didn't realise we booked Sherlock Holmes.
But anyway, no, and then, of course, they turned on the news and it was like, oh, my goodness, you know, this is happening again. It's just... relentless at the moment. It feels relentless, you know.
Tez, how did you feel after that attack?
Whenever something happens bad that's on the news, that's like stops every other type of news happening, whether it's like a terrorist attack or something like that, my first thought is, oh, please don't be Muslim. And then this one, it was, well, the Muslims were the victims, and it was really scary because, like, if Tell Mama are an organization that record and hate crimes against Muslims.
Yeah.
And they've seen an exponential rise in hate attacks against Muslims over the last few years. And interestingly, a lot of those attacks, they're happening all over the country, and a lot of them are by men against visibly Muslim women. So a really frightening time at the moment. And What's weird is that a lot of people who hate Muslims, a lot of the bigots out there, they say they do it because they try and co-opt female rights because they hate Islam.
Yeah.
But interestingly, they're really physically and verbally abusive against women. It'd be like me standing up for animal rights but while wearing a leather jacket, eating a steak and organising a cockfight.
Well, I felt... It was weird, because when it happened, I felt angry, because I thought, well, this guy doesn't represent me and I want people to know that. And then I kind of started to think, holy shit, what are the reprisals going to be like? And then realised, that must be... Is that what you feel like whenever it's someone who claims they're doing it because of ISIS?
Yeah, because I hate ISIS. Every Muslim I know hates ISIS. Like, ISIS do not represent mainstream British Muslims. Like, me in the same way that Darren Osborne, who did that earlier this week, doesn't represent white people, in the same way that football hooligans don't represent David Beckham or the Daily Mail don't represent journalism.
Yeah. Someone called Martin Whittle said, is it OK that people like Haiti Copkins are not treated the same as Abu Hamza and sent to prison for hate preaching? Now, here's an interesting thing. The day after the Finsbury Park attack, Katie Hopkins retweeted a video of a man being arrested for attacking a police officer outside Paddington Station. She tweeted the video and said, Allah Akbar, attack on police at Paddington, well filmed. Here's the thing. The guy being arrested was actually swearing in Romanian. At 20 minutes after the attack, police tweeted to say it wasn't even terror-related. But the problem is, the police message got 200 retweets, Katie Hopkins got 2,000. And then the phrase Allah Akbar started trending on Twitter and people around Britain thought there had been another attack. Mm. All because of this, basically...
A turd the size of Disneyland Paris.
Now, all of this is bad enough when it happens on a Twitter feed to hundreds of thousands of followers, but let's be honest, as you said, this is no different to what goes on in a number of daily newspapers on a regular basis. OK, all of those stories might be based originally in fact, but often they distort those facts to give you...
Cow chutney.
Then they exaggerate them until they become...
A shite in shining armour.
And then add an inflammatory headline to present what can only be described as...
Thomas the Wank Engine.
And you can't tell me that those headlines don't have an effect on people.
Because Muslims, we just want to be treated like everyone else. Some Muslims are great, some Muslims are good, some Muslims are OK, and some Muslims are bellends. But they're bellends because they're bellends, not because they're Muslim. Mm. Some Muslims will commit a crime, but it seems like when a Muslim person commits a crime, it gets fetishised and blown out of proportion. And it seems like the media in this country has groomed the most susceptible in society to trust its own worst fears and bigotry, and it's awful, and they need to stop.
Well, on that, what I need to show you, this week marked the start of a new online segment of The Last League called Correspondence. Each week we're sending people out to investigate the world. You can see them on all four. Tez went out this week to find out why people become radicalised. Here's a sneak preview.
People seem to suggest that I, as a British Muslim, should be doing more to stop extremists. But I don't know any extremists. Are other people trying to stop them? And no one's told me about it.
Assalamu alaikum, Amro.
Alaikum salam.
Bro, I'm just wondering, what have you done to combat extremists today?
Today? I have done nothing.
How many terrorists have you caught today?
Today?
Yeah.
None.
Oh.
Yeah.
So what have you been up to?
Studying, raising my children.
Right.
Not personally knowing any terrorists.
Oh, that probably doesn't help.
No.
I mean, some of these questions are a bit weird. Like, what is any community doing to combat any of their criminals? Hi, guys. I'm just wondering what you two are doing about embezzlement in the financial industry. Hi, guys. I'm just wondering what you're doing to discourage embezzlement in the financial industry. Hiya, mate. I'm just wondering what you're doing about embezzlement in the financial industry, so no one wants to take any responsibility. It's weird.
We'll be back with more of The Last Leg of the Bit. It's Josh wrapped up The Last 7 days. We'll see you soon. Last leg, we're still joined by Kathy Burke and Tez Ilias. Alex has decided to get in a paddling pool for the last bit of the
decided
show.
Slash been made to by the producers.
Josh has been casting a net across the last 7 days. What have you got?
Yes, would you like to see a child having the time of his life on an out-of-control go-kart turned into the catchiest viral remix ever?
Yes.
Of course you would.
Ha ha ha!
said, is it OK that the UK has a day of rage, a year of slightly miffed? Sounds more British. Yeah, a group called Movement for Justice by Any Means Necessary called for a day of rage to shut down London and remove the government on Wednesday. It started at 1 p.m. because Britain rages to a schedule.
Well, I'm not saying it wasn't a success. But that's the first I've heard of it.
It was meant to start at 1. It started at 1:30 because of low attendance.
How are you meant to tell if people are on a day of rage or just commuting in London?
Well, the idea was to walk from Shepherd's Bush to Downing Street. It was a 34-degree day. It was a day of rage on the afternoon of sweaty ass cracks. OK, briefly, we asked for your Brexit song lyrics. Let's see. Yes, Alex?
Ho, ho, ho.
Your Brex is on fire. We are never, ever, ever getting back together. Teresa, are you OK? Are you OK, Teresa? You've been struck by a hard Brexit. That's all we've got time for tonight. Would you please thank our guest, Kathy Burke? And Tez Ilias. And my co-host, Josh Widdicombe. And Alex Brooker. Next week, we'll be joined by the man who played Gollum himself, Andy Serkis. But this week, we've learnt two things. It's important to keep cool, and things are funny when they spin. Thanks for watching The Last Leg. My name's Adam Hills. See you next week for the next leg.